preparing for today gave me a little bit of time to reflect on those 10 years and conclude that I was lucky to learn early on that there's no need to face sustainability challenges alone. Throughout my career, I've used the power of partnerships to create solutions. Having all the difficult conversations with a diverse range of stakeholders is a great shortcut to creating transformational change. That learning in those foundation years created the perfect on-the-job training for my fastest, most challenging, and most inspiring role yet. A role that has allowed me to embrace the notion of having zero ambition without taking offence. So just to understand my audience, does anyone have tickets to the Olympic or Paralympic Games, or did anyone venture out to go and see the torch as it passed through Bristol? It's always good to know who your audience is, and if I had none of you raising hands, then I probably would say thank you very much and head out. But for the last 3 years, I have been working for London 2012, organising committee for the Olympic and Paralympic Games. We are, within the family of London 2012, the people that plan and put on the Games. We've worked hand in hand with the developers of the Olympic Park. They're called the Olympic Delivery Authority. And we're in the process of handing our baton very quickly to the future owners of the Queen Elizabeth Olympic Park. They're called the London Legacy Development Corporation. From the beginning, the bar was set very high. Winning the bid to host the Olympic Games gave London's four host boroughs, Newham, Hackney, Tower Hamlets and Waltham Forest, the opportunity to create a lasting legacy and to fast forward a development agenda that would normally have taken 30 years. We've had 7. Our ambition from the outset has been to deliver the most sustainable games, or as Jonathon once described it, the least unsustainable games. In partnership with WWF and BioOriginal, our strategy, One Planet Olympics, described the games guided by the principle that the world must live within its means. Our One Planet framework is simple to understand, but for a project of this size and scale, and complex challenge to deliver. From the very beginning, we set aggressive targets on carbon, energy, and waste. We also set stringent sourcing criteria and ambitious visions for food, travel, and resource use. The easiest way to understand the complexity is first to understand the scale. And to do that, the easiest way is to talk about one of our venues, the main venue, the Olympic Park. So, in the beginning, the landscape had been shaped by 150 years of industry. The skyline was dotted with 52 pylons, and inside were car yards, fridge mountains, railway sidings, London's first only smoked salmon factory owned by the Foreman family, and some allotments. By the time I arrived in 2009, 2 million tonnes of polluted soil was already being cleaned for reuse in 6 giant soil washing machines. The stadium was already a hole in the ground, and the rivers had emerged from 70 years of neglect. A wetland bowl was being carved out around the River Lea and planted 380,000 wetland plants. Not only would it create a beautiful parkland landscape, but it was also saving 5,000 homes from risk from a 1-in-100-year storm, so from flooding. Sustainable construction may not be new, but sustainable construction at this scale is. Over 6 years, the ODA recruited over 40,000 people, and together they've built a stadium, an aquatic centre, swimming pools, a handball arena, basketball arena, velodrome, tennis centre, BMX track, 45-hectare parkland, and housing for 17.5 athletes and officials. If we take the Olympic Stadium as one example of that approach to sustainable construction, it seats 80,000. It's the lightest that has ever been built, using 75% less steel than the bird's nest in Beijing. It was built using low-carbon concrete made from recycled materials and therefore contains 40% less embodied carbon than industry standard. It was built for legacy. Most of it is bolted rather than welded, and it can be dismantled to create a 25,000 stadium, 40,000, 60,000, depending on the need. And its design was changed to incorporate what I love on the very top, the round ring, are recycled gas pipes, which saved 9 tonnes of carbon emissions. My favourite venue, the beautiful velodrome, former home of the Eastway Cycle Park, will become a brand new velo park after the Games, incorporating the velodrome and the BMX track. Its design means it's the most energy efficient on the park, and it can be naturally lit and ventilated, which will reduce its running costs and legacy. It was also redesigned to incorporate 16 kilometres of cable net roof rather than using steel struts. That also saved about 1,000 tons of steel. There are obviously lots of targets behind all of this, and most of them, there's only one that hasn't been reached, which I will mention later, have been hit or gone beyond. So 58% reduction in carbon emissions against a 50% target. 98.5% of demolition waste has been reused, recycled against a 90% target. And 99% of construction waste has been reused, recycled, or recovered against the same target. And finally, 67% of materials were transported by water or rail against a 50% target. By setting clear targets, supported by policies, procedures, contractual requirements, and strong leadership from the top, the ODA have been successful in delivering a very comprehensive sustainability programme. I mentioned one target that wasn't hit, and that was the renewables target. A very public failing was our inability to reach the 20% target. Our mistake was to put all our eggs in one basket. We had expected to be able to put a wind turbine, a 2 megawatt wind turbine, but when the marketplace and legislation changed, we were pretty stuck. Having designed our buildings to be very light, we couldn't just use solar as the solution, but we had to rethink. And therefore, we've used some solar panels around the park, but we've also invested in a program that will retrofit 2,800 homes and 12 schools in the host boroughs, allowing us to reach that target in different forms. Many of those who worked on the project are amazed that for the first time they saw cross-specialized specialist partnerships form. Engineers sat around with architects, designers, concrete suppliers, and transport providers to find better ways. Working on a project like this, you can't help but be inspired by what your fellow teams have achieved. I can't take any personal credit for their achievements, but I hope I've done them justice. Zeronauts existed across the construction programme. Whether it was the welder who always segregated his waste, or the specially set up timber panel who traced every piece of wood used on the park to its original source and legal, sustainable and legal source. Every one of those 40,000 workers played their part. So let's turn our attention to the actual event. We also set a number of ambitious targets. We want 100% of spectators to travel by public transport, walking or cycling. We want to deliver 14 million sustainably sourced meals. And we want zero waste to landfill during the Games. Again, I'm speaking on behalf of remarkably passionate people who've taken these targets and worked furiously to achieve them. Firstly, there's Nicola, our active travel program manager. It's her role to bring together all the different groups who are interested in walking and cycling to inspire 6,000 walking and cycling journeys to the Olympic Park and 1 million extra journeys per day in London. She's finding fun and engaging ways of bringing people together to allow them to find new ways of travel. David launched our food vision in 2009. Following intense discussions involving all sectors in the food chain, farmers, campaigners, fair trade, government, sponsors, the first sustainable food policy for the Games or any major event was agreed. Yes, you'll still be able to get your hamburgers and hot dogs if that's what you'd like, but you'll also be able to buy sustainably sourced fish with your chips, perhaps a free-range egg sandwich, and know that you can enjoy your meals with the knowledge that we've taken great care to source legally, to source locally and responsibly, rather than legally. Then there is Libby, our famous bins. She's tasked with helping every single person who comes to the Games to put their rubbish in the right bin, whether that's compostable, recyclable, or non-recyclable. To help, we've placed coloured icons on all of our catering packaging. If it has an orange symbol on it, please put it in the orange bin. If it has a green one, please put it in the green bin. And if it doesn't have either of those, then please put it in the non-recyclables black bin. It all sounds so simple. But only working in partnership with experts from the Waste and Resources Action Programme, alongside our packaging and bin suppliers, we've been able to deliver this. All we need now is everyone to follow those simple instructions and help us celebrate Libby, who will be a real Zeronaut, with her zero waste to landfill target. Of course, it doesn't always go to plan. Despite a thorough set of guidelines and our sourcing code and a strong procurement process, this year there have been allegations of poor working conditions at three overseas factories manufacturing London 2012 goods. In preparation for these types of allegations, we set up our own complaints and dispute resolution process in 2011 that triggers independent investigations and reports on all allegations and the actions that need to be taken. So having told you my story, you'll now know that although I stand here in front of you as a fully fledged Zeronaut, I really represent the amazing team at London 2012 who've worked so hard to deliver all of these stretch targets. As the Paralympic Games come to an end on September the 9th, we and LOCOG can start to review whether our plans have been successful. Although we already know we have created a tipping point and we have changed the events industry and future games forever, we don't yet know whether we've reached all those targets and delivered a truly sustainable games. For those that built the Olympic Park, the journey is just beginning. It will be open to the public for the first time in next summer, which is 8 years after it was first envisioned. Only then, when those fences come down, will we see how the new community and the postal code of E20 integrates into the surrounding boroughs. That is when we will start to get the first indications of whether the 50-year vision for the Queen Elizabeth Olympic Park has succeeded. Thank you. 30 seconds early.
So now we have our third speaker, Michael Pawlyn, and he has been running a company called Exploration Architecture since 2007 to focus exclusively on biomimicry, which, all, as we all know, is an aspect of sustainability. Prior to setting up this company, he was working with Nicholas Grimshaw in building the Eden project, which was one of the truly innovative buildings of the last century. He was responsible for leading the design team of the warm, temperate, and humid tropics biomes and the subsequent phases that included proposals for a third biome for plants for dry tropical regions. Over to you, Michael.
Thank you very much, Herbie, and thank you very much for inviting me to talk here today. I'm going to be talking about my favorite subject, biomimicry. And this is really about looking to nature as a source of inspiration for new solutions. And I think there are some pretty big and challenging zero targets we're going to need to address over the next few decades, such as zero fossil fuels, zero waste, zero toxins. And for me, biomimicry is just one of the best sources of innovation to address those challenges. You could look at nature as being like a kind of storehouse of design ideas that have all benefited from a 3.8 billion year research and development period. And to make things even better, all the faulty products have been withdrawn from the marketplace. And so you can find examples like spiders, which make silk stronger than far stronger than Kevlar, with zero waste, zero toxins, and a fraction of the energy. This lizard here, the thorny devil, this can drink with its feet if it's standing on damp ground. Water tracks up the grooves in its skin to its mouth and licks its lips and looks rather pleased with itself. The sand skin can swim in sand without suffering any abrasion at all. We could use that to develop scratch-proof coatings. The bombardier beetle, this has evolved an adaptation as a defense against predators. It fires a high-temperature explosion out of its rear end. It's got two fuel tanks and a combustion chamber that mix high explosives, and the valves on those inlets open and close 200 times a second to stop the explosion migrating back to the fuel tanks. These are examples of the kind of new technologies that we could develop. We tend to think that humans are sophisticated, but actually there's far more sophisticated solutions in nature, and we could learn a lot from studying those. Another example here. This is the closest that humans have got to the bombardier beetle. The Messerschmitt 163 used the same, exactly the same chemicals, hydrazine and hydrogen peroxide, but most of them exploded on the ground. I'm just going to talk very briefly about three projects, really. One of these is an office building. We've been working on a concept study for a new office building using biomimicry to try and go beyond standard approaches to sustainable design. I think we need to move beyond sustainability to achieve restorative models. And these were the aims that we set ourselves. Some of these are zero aims. So we wanted to create a zero fossil fuel building with zero net energy, and we wanted it to actually be restorative. We wanted it to boost productivity, for the air coming out to be cleaner than the air going in, and for it actually to produce a surplus of energy. And biomimicry often works by just asking all sorts of questions of nature. Yeah, how would nature harvest and distribute light? And actually there are loads of examples. The spookfish has mirror structures in its eyes that focus very low-level bioluminescence. The stone plant, most of that plant lives below the ground, and it has a roof light that brings light down to the photosynthetic matter. And the brittle star, this is a starfish that lives 500 meters below the surface, and its skin is covered in optically perfect lenses that focus very low levels of light onto receptors, and so it can detect a predator before the predator finds it. And we use those and many other examples to help us, to really force us to be much more inventive with the way we brought light into this building. And we also use nature and biomimicry to develop super-efficient structures, looking at the incredibly lightweight structures that you find in bird skulls, where you have several layers of very thin, bony tissue connected with struts and ties. It's like a combination of dome technology and space frame technology, all in a humble garden bird. We also looked at examples of thermoregulation in nature. How could we control the temperature inside this building in completely passive ways? And of course, termites have mastered zero-waste sustainable agriculture and solar-powered air conditioning long before we've got anywhere near it. So for us, zero targets are a really important driver. They help us to achieve breakthrough points. And this is an example of a kind of breakthrough point achieved at the Rocky Mountain Institute headquarters. This is a building above the snow line in Colorado. And what Amory Lovins, who set this up, talks about is this idea of tunneling through the cost barrier. Often with sustainability, particularly on buildings, you add more and more features, better insulation, better windows, etc. And then you get to the point where you can't afford any more. And that's often where things stop. But what Amory Lovins says is that you need to be able to go further than that. And if you optimize the whole system and make the whole envelope really super insulated, then you get to the point where you can design out the heating system. And then that brings you down to a solution that is actually cheaper than a standard cost. And that building, which is above the snow line, as I mentioned, is 99% passive solar heated. And that's what we're trying to do on this biomimetic office building. We're trying to get to these breakthrough points where we can design out a lot of the mechanical energy-consuming equipment. One of the big shifts that we need to make, I think, is from a linear way of using resources to a closed-loop model. And again, ecosystems are a fantastic example of how this has been achieved. There are a few examples. John mentioned one, Kalundborg, where we humans have tried to mimic the efficiencies of ecosystems in which the waste from one organism becomes the nutrient for something else. And one of my favorite examples is one set up by a guy called Graham Wiles. It's called the Cardboard to Caviar Project. And the way this works is that they collected cardboard from shops and restaurants. They then shredded it and they sold it to equestrian centers as horse bedding. When that was soiled, they were paid again to collect it. They put it into wormery composting systems, which produced a lot of worms, which they fed to Siberian sturgeon, which produced caviar, which they sold back to the restaurants. Which is quite nice because it's turned this linear, wasteful system into a closed-loop model. And the more detailed version of this project, I think, is in many ways more interesting because it started simply as a way of involving people with disabilities in a recycling initiative. And it only went as far as the equestrian center. And then Graham Wiles decided to set up a fish farm, and this time he was working with reforming heroin addicts, a pretty difficult group. And in this part of the UK, the local authority was spending as much as £100,000 per addict on rehabilitation programs that were having a 95% failure rate. Graham's achieved a 65% success rate at getting kids off drugs and back into more productive pursuits. And what's lovely about this scheme is the way he kept on adding more and more things to it. So, for instance, in winter, they found that the fish weren't putting on enough weight. So, by this stage, they've been given some land by Yorkshire Water, and they rehabilitated this industrial land with sewage waste, fertilizer. They planted biomass, which ran a biomass boiler, which improved the water temperature. He got the kids growing vegetables to supplement the worms. They started growing orchards. They used watercress to treat the wastewater from the fish tanks. And now they're using moldy bread to grow maggots, which has none of the smells of meat-based production, as another supplement for the fish food. And he's adding another element, which is a smokehouse, and this time working with people that have returned from conflict zones. And people coming back from conflict zones often come back with disabilities, post-traumatic stress disorder, and a lot of them end up in prison. And whatever we might think of the rights and wrongs of the Iraq War, it's, these people have given a really major sacrifice, and I think they deserve better treatment. And so what is, I think, great about this project is the way it's evolved like an ecosystem, and it's grown in resilience and diversity over time, turning more and more waste streams into productive cycles. And he's been invented with every form of waste. Arguably the most deplorable form of waste is underutilized human resources. And he's managed to reintegrate three marginalized groups, people with disabilities, heroin addicts, and people returning from conflict zones. So I think that's an absolutely great scheme. And it really captures some of the main differences between human-made systems and natural systems. So we tend to make simple, disconnected, and monofunctional systems. Nature makes more complex, interconnected ones. Ours tend to be linear and wasteful. Ours tend to be resistant to change. We use long-term toxins. Nature doesn't. Ours is centralized, fossil fuel dependent. Nature runs on current solar income, et cetera, et cetera. I don't need to go through all of those. But I think that list on the right there is actually a fantastic summary of where we need to be heading when we rethink our cities and our industries and societies. The final project I'm going to talk about is the Sahara Forest Project. And it came as a surprise to me to learn that a lot of the world's deserts were actually vegetated a fairly short time ago. North Africa, when Julius Caesar arrived, was covered in cedar trees and cypress trees. And he set about clearing those and establishing intensive farms. And within about 200 years, that landscape was effectively trashed. They transported millions of tons of grain back to the Roman Empire and transferred vast quantities of minerals from the soils of North Africa out into the Mediterranean in a classic extractive and linear and wasteful system. So on the Sahara Forest Project, what we're trying to do is to rethink this flawed paradigm of an extractive model, and we're trying to go beyond a sustainable model to actually achieve a restorative model. And here, a lot of the inspiration came from one of my personal favorites, the Namibian fog basking beetle, which has evolved a way of harvesting its own fresh water in a desert. And the way that it does this is that it comes out of its hiding place at night, it crawls to the top of a sand dune, and because it's got this matte black shell, it's able to radiate heat out to the night sky and become slightly cooler than its surroundings. So when the moist breeze blows in off the sea, you get these droplets of water forming on the beetle's shell just before the sun comes up, tips its shell up, the water runs down to its mouth, has a good drink, goes off and hides for the rest of the day. I think it's fair to say it's not a great quality of life, but it's a clever trick, and that's good enough for me. And I'm not sure if this animation is going to work. It wasn't working earlier, so I'll just carry on. So at its core, this project is about bringing together two established technologies. One of these is a greenhouse, which is cooled and humidified with seawater, which creates a much better growing environment for crops in arid regions. And then we harvest some of that humidity as fresh water in a process that's effectively identical to the beetle. And the other sort of symbiotic partner with this saltwater cooled greenhouse is concentrated solar power. This uses mirrors to focus the sun's heat to create electricity. And it turns out that these two technologies have some very interesting synergies. Firstly, they both work very well in hot, sunny deserts. Concentrated solar power, or CSP, that benefits from seawater cooling and produces a lot of waste heat, which we can use in the greenhouses to create more fresh water. And the shade under the mirrors actually makes it possible to grow a whole range of crops that would not grow in direct sunlight. So a number of really important synergies. And what we're proposing really is that we create this long hedge of greenhouses facing the prevailing wind direction with concentrated solar power plants at intervals along the way, giving the benefit of these synergies. And then that's an illustration of what a really big scheme might look like. And what we've been doing over the last year is we've been trying to optimize this system, looking at a whole range of technologies in terms of their inputs and outputs, and really trying to get to something equivalent to an ecosystem in which all the outputs become inputs for something else in that system. So it's more than just the greenhouse and CSP. We're also looking at halophytes, crops growing in seawater, algae. We're looking at harvesting all the salts and the waste minerals so that we can get those back into the desert soils. And that's how it looks overall now as a system, where we're trying to get all these different technologies integrated. And while that might look complicated, it's nowhere near as complicated as an ecosystem, which might have 1,000 different species, all of which have interesting interactions. But really what we're trying to do is to create a model for how we could grow zero-carbon food in some of the most water-stressed parts of the planet, zero fossil fuel energy, and revegetate areas of desert. And we're now in the process of building a pilot version of this in Qatar in time for the climate change talks in Doha, and we're hoping to scale up to build a bigger version in Jordan. So to draw some conclusions now, well, people sometimes ask me if I'm an optimist or a pessimist about the future, and I think that's the wrong question because that implies an inevitability about the future. And actually, there's nothing inevitable about the future. The future is what we create, if we choose to. The future is what we create every moment of our waking lives, moment to moment to moment. We are creating the future. And I think we should decide on the future we want and then set about creating it. I think we're in the early stages of the shift from the industrial age of mankind to the ecological age. And I firmly believe that it'll be biomimicry that help us find a lot of the solutions we're going to need. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Michael, for this truly inspiring contribution and bringing in really new perspectives that many of us would not have heard before. So thank you very much. I'm sure there will be many questions, and I think many people here will probably want to join your company before the end of the day. So now Jonathon is going to be the last speaker, but also commentator on part of what he's heard. Now, I think you all know Jonathon very well. I think several of you have been here several evenings, but certainly Jonathon could be called Mr. Green, really, couldn't he? I mean, Forum for the Future, he was the head of the Sustainable Development Commission. He's co-director of the Princess of Wales Business and Sustainability Programme. But above all else, I think for the benefit of those who haven't fully been aware of this, I mean, he was really the spiritus rector of the Big Green Week here in Bristol, and Forum for the Future has got a very, very strong and active presence in Bristol. So thank you for coming this evening, and look forward to listening to you.
Thank you, Herbie. Well, I must say, I can't imagine being anywhere else in the world other than here this evening, because that is just the most wonderful celebration, that's the word that jumps out at me, celebration of this incredible spirit that is now emerging at the heart of the Green Movement. And I just think from time to time we need to step back and really understand what is going on here, because what you've heard from those three talks is such an affirmation of our ability to bring forward solutions to these really dire problems that we're facing in the world today. And the first Schumacher lecture in here on Saturday last weekend was given by Clive Hamilton, and we were sharing some fairly gloomy insights into the speed with which accelerating climate change is kind of narrowing the space for the solutions. So what a fantastic contrast this evening to think a bit about that portfolio of solutions coming forward. So for me, very interesting. What we had tonight was a celebration of the natural world, and I love Michael's work on this and the way he's kind of turned all that, the work of Janine Benyus and others now, into some very practical insights into how to make this stuff work on the ground. Celebration of the natural world, celebration of the human genius, because that's really what we all depend on now to engineer our way through to a rather better world. And I think John's book in Zeronauts is doing that in an incredible way. And from Felicity, you heard something which is just as important, which is a celebration of the way in which we can now combine materials in different ways to create really important, more sustainable outcomes for society at large. And that made me think a bit about Schumacher, of course. I'd like to do that on a Schumacher lecture because it's quite important. And I'm sure some of you will remember that Schumacher was quite cross about people who used to think that all of his collected work was really a full-on attack on what was called materialism in those days. And there was a big thing about the wickedness of materialism. And Schumacher was very keen to remind people that really materialism wasn't the problem. Because if we thought more carefully about and approached the use of materials differently, the world wouldn't have looked quite so stupid as it did to him even in those days. For him, Materialism is not the problem. It was our abuse of materials that was the problem. And that made me think a little bit about capitalism, because I'm sure you also know Fritz Schumacher himself was just a touch ambivalent about capitalism, to say the least. He was actually far more left-wing than most people really understand if you look back over his lifetime, which is what makes me quite cross when I hear people like David Cameron suddenly jumping on the small is beautiful bandwagon, as if this would allow him to get a little bit of the Schumacher aura draped around him. If he really knew what Schumacher stood for in that regard, I don't think he would have given him any breathing space at all. But Schumacher was not an out-and-out anti-capitalist. For him, the problem wasn't capitalism, it was the abuse of capital. And that's a really important point, because the missing dimension this evening, with all the three talks that we've heard, human genius, brilliant natural world, use of materials, the missing dimension is capital. Because what you have to understand, we all have to understand, is that to make that vision of the future work, we have to find the capital and invest the capital in those brilliant ideas and people, initiatives and companies to bring the solutions to scale within the very short period of time that we have available to us. And that, of course, touches on an interesting tension in the green movement, is we're never really very sure how to approach this issue about capitalism. We're quite comfortable about the idea that to make all of those brilliant things work will require billions, probably trillions of dollars of investment. We really like that. And when you clapped John and Felicity and Michael, you were, in essence, clapping the idea that collectively society will find the financial capital to make those ideas come to fruition. But when you invite people to go a little bit further and celebrate capitalism, oh my God, that's really just insane. And very few greenies will ever, ever do anything resembling that. So for me, what we heard this evening is such an important reminder of the complexity at the heart of our own movement. And that's why a lot of people devote themselves to what Schumacher would have identified as the real problem, not capitalism itself, but the abuse of capital, which is how do we get capital allocated to make the world work in the way that you've heard about this evening, rather than work in a way that is trashing the prospects for everybody. How do we correct some of the chronic market failure going on in capitalism today? Much of these things depend on markets reflecting the true price of things rather than actually giving an explicit and implicit subsidy to people who are destroying that value of the natural world. How do we deal with this horror story of incumbency? Michael didn't talk about this in his session this evening. John didn't talk about it, but getting in the way of all of these Zeronauts, of all of these brilliant people, are all the has-been incumbent power brokers from the last 40 or 50 years who wouldn't be clapping very loudly at what you heard this evening, but would actually be thinking to themselves, whoa, how do I make sure that doesn't happen? And these incumbent power brokers are essentially what makes capitalism the lethal force that it is in the world today. Which is why we can't ignore it. We have to think of ways in which we address ourselves to that issue of the abuse of capital to ensure that capital flows in such a way to deliver the solutions that we really need. So that's quite a challenge for all of us. We find this quite a tricky one to deal with in the forum. I think we all find it quite tricky. And I was reminded how tricky it was because actually the session I was at here this afternoon before this final Schumacher lecture as part of the Big Green Week was a session with some colleagues from Common Cause looking at the Bristol Pound and looking at the way in which the Bristol Pound could completely shake up this idea about how we finance wealth creation in a local economy. And it's a very interesting proposal. It's developing in all sorts of ways. And it made me think, when I was listening to John, it made me think that I haven't had a chance to read the book yet, obviously, I've only just got it, but it made me think we need not just the technological Zeronauts, the people who are brilliant in terms of technology and materials and all that genius. We need barefoot Zeronauts. We need legions of people who can work as empowering agents in society, at the community level, to enable people to go to zero, to enable all of us to find lifestyles that permit us to be as close to a Zeronaut as we can in our own backyard, in our workplace, in the community where we live. And we need that barefoot Zeronaut genius, if you like, as much as we need the technology genius, the ability to translate the astonishing wonders of nature into wealth and so on. Does that sort of square the circle? Can we do both the dealing with the scourge of capitalism on the one hand and deal with the community non-capitalist side of things on the other hand? I'm not sure. It looks to me like there is a both-and world available to us in the green movement, and I think we need both aspects of that, absolutely. But I can't deny that there is some real creative tension between those two approaches. There really is. If you dedicate yourself to making capitalism work, it's sometimes quite tricky to connect as closely as we need to with this concept of community-based, transition-led, barefoot Zeronauts at that level. However, that kind of tension is very much part and parcel of the human genius, so I don't think we should be at all worried about it. I think we should just get out and celebrate that too. Thank you.
Well, I'm amazed that after such an active week, you still have the energy to deliver such an incisive and clearly formulated presentation. So thank you very much, Jonathon, for that. Now it's over to you. Now there's going to be a bias towards women contributors in this discussion. So if anybody would like to start raising their hands, of course there's already a man's hand over there, but anyway, so well, you can start, but you're not going to be the, you know, we're going to make sure that it's going to be half and half at least. But anyway, if you start over there, and then we will, any other hands? Yes, I've just seen you over there as well. So please come and tell us what you have to say.
Hello. My question's about corporate social responsibility, or CSR, and can you transform a vulture into a dove? I'm glad to see there's brilliant things going on at the Olympics, but I'm concerned that the real winners are the visible sponsors and organisers, Coca-Cola and Deloitte, who represent unhealthy consumption and mass-mindedness.
So I think I know who that is directed to. At least in the first person to respond will be you, Felicity. You want it?
Thank you for your question. Working with sponsors is one of the things that all of us do in terms of managing events. My role, personally, is to influence, challenge, and do everything I can in terms of corporate responsibility remit and the games to influence them to make the right choices for the games. Beyond that, I can't influence in terms of their full portfolio and their broader agendas.
Jonathon?
So are they all vultures? Well, that's an interesting story, really. I mean, it is true that the London 2012 Olympics inherited those top-tier sponsors that have agreed to sponsor the Olympics from here until the crack of doom, so far as I can tell. So the likes of Coca-Cola and McDonald's are top-tier forever sponsors. And then there's another tier of sponsors which kick in underneath that for London. And then there's a group of sponsors which are known as the sustainability sponsors, and obviously Felicity and I have been dealing mostly with them. And of course, some of them are extraordinarily problematic. I mean, you can't turn away from that. It is difficult if BP is one of your sustainability sponsors. It's difficult if EDF is one of your sustainability sponsors, particularly difficult for me. It's difficult if Dow, with some of the legacy story about Dow, is one of your big sponsors. So look, this is not comfortable. And actually, to be fair, everybody has been impaled somewhat on the difficulties associated with this. And I'm not going to try and give you a spun answer here, because it's caused a lot of continuing, really conscientious reflection about how you deal with those old companies and seek to make the most of the contribution they can make to the Olympics to get the best out of the sustainability bang that they bring with them. Is that is that an example of the kind of both and compromise I was talking about before? Possibly. It is just extremely difficult, and I think that we've worked on a supplement for Green Futures with Felicity, and we're going to try and tease out some of these issues about what you do with very big corporate interests whose main business, whether it's nuclear power or tar sands in Athabasca, is about as far away from sustainability as you can get. That's a genuine dilemma.
So I think, John, you work with companies a lot, so please tell us your perspective on this.
Maybe I can take the discussion. Sponsorship is, the politics of sponsorship are problematic always, unless you're extremely lucky with the particular companies who come towards you. But yes, I for 35, 40 years, I've worked with a very broad range of companies, and one of them is Dow Chemical, which has caused a great deal of controversy, primarily because it bought the assets of Union Carbide in Bhopal and India, stupidly. And at the time, we told them they shouldn't do that, and their response was they could legally cap the issues that related back to the Bhopal disaster, and we told them, no, there is a moral, there's an ethical liability here, not just simply a legal liability. Put that to one side, though. It's difficult to do so, but just for a moment, put that to one side. In the 60s, when I was at university first, Dow was the great Satan. It really was. I mean, this was one of the companies that was making Agent Orange and so on, and defoliants for the Vietnam War. Much more recently, I've seen that company go through some sort of convulsion internally. And so, for example, a couple of years back, we did an exercise that looks out to the year when they will be 200 years old, which is 2087. And they're already thinking about how they embrace some of the stuff, for example, that Michael was working on, some of the stuff that Forum of the Future been working on. But they've got a process internally which is very much about adapting what they do to those new ways of valuing natural capital and so on. Will they do it? I simply don't know. The perils of trying to turn around an incumbent company are often monstrous. And just one final note. We did a conference about 3 weeks ago in London, and we had three major companies on the stage who I wanted on the stage because the speakers were people who were trying to drive change from inside those companies. They were entrepreneurs. All three of them told me after that they were leaving those major companies because they found it so difficult to drive the processes of change. I hate to say it, but unhappily true.
Right, so I'm sure there's going to be other questions in that sort of general context. The lady over there, you've got the microphone.
I'm very conscious whenever I hear these very positive messages that all the good is being undone by spiralling world population. Is this all going to be enough to kind of make for a sustainable future for grandchildren when the grandchildren may number 15 billion? And is there a political appetite for actually asking people in the West, where consumption is high and child mortality is low, to lead the way in reducing family size?
Who wants to kick that off?
Well, let somebody else go. I'm very happy to say something on the subject.
Well, I know that Jonathon addressed the issue in some detail a week ago, but maybe you should start just to sort of...
Well, let me just say that I think population is absolutely fundamental. Whether it goes to 9 or 10 billion people, or whether, as the UN is starting to say, it might go to sort of as many as 15 billion as you reference. I mean, I think we're screwed, to use a technical term, even with 7 billion people. The biosphere is already coming apart at the seams. So population is fundamental. And in the book, one of the things I've done is to look at the zero population movement and how that has played through, particularly in China, and all of the demographic and other implications of that. And we've got to start to moderate our populations much more seriously than we've done to date. But there are a bunch of other issues that come with that. And when you have aging societies, they become particularly complex. The reason why I went for zero was simply I don't think there's any way that we can get to anything like sustainability with change as usual strategies. We've really got to stretch ourselves to almost a painful degree. So perhaps enough there, and perhaps over to Jonathon.
So very quickly, I totally agree that we have to get this one sorted out. There are a growing number of people who are now prepared to accept that this is as big a priority as anything else we're facing, but it's difficult still. So just let me put this in context very quickly. So zero population growth means, it doesn't mean that people stop having children, you understand. It just means that our population doesn't, the rate of growth in our population does not increase. And in fact, our rate of growth in the global population is declining and will continue to decline. And average fertility is declining and will continue to decline. But the difference between the speed of that decline, either very slow or hopefully very fast as we go back down, is critical. Because just conjure with this little fact. Population replacement level is 2.1 children per woman. If we manage to get to 2.1, the human population will stabilize by the end of the century. If we get this wrong and average fertility goes to 2.6 children, stays at 2.6 children per woman, we could easily see a population of 10, 11 billion people on this planet. I think we'd probably all say that's going to be really tricky. If we get it down to about 1.8, 1.7 children per woman, then we have a chance of stabilizing at somewhere closer to 8.25 billion. And that is a very realistic target. There is no reason at all why we shouldn't aim at an 8 billion target instead of a 9, 10, or 11 billion target. It's perfectly doable. And there are brilliant examples of amazing champions at the community level who've led family planning campaigns that have helped get us towards that target.
I'd just like to comment briefly as well. I mean, for instance, take China, which has the one-child policy, or pretty much still being implemented, but they have about 8 to 10% economic growth per year as well. So, you know, the one person being born will become a consumer sooner or later on a Western scale. So the human numbers is not the only issue in this context. I mean, Paul Ehrlich, when he first wrote the book Population Bomb, had the formula, which is numbers multiplied by consumption patterns multiplied by resource use. And that is certainly the key issue. You can't just talk about human numbers alone. There's a term that's being bandied about increasingly now called sustainable intensification. In other words, we have, over time, since, you know, we were hunter-gatherers, where we have a few million people on this planet, grown to tens of millions, hundreds of millions now, all these billions of us. And so each time there is this step up towards ever larger numbers, we need to find new processes of intensification. And the critical question is how we can have a more intensive relationship to the environment that is a circular relationship rather than the kind of linear relationship that we talked about. Because if we have massive human numbers increase whilst at the same time wasteful production systems, then we really are in trouble. So the next person would like to, I think you, could you bring the microphone?
Yeah, I'm sorry to follow that very important issue with something else and perhaps not quite so important, but my concern from hearing people talk, especially about the Olympics, is that I fear that a lot of this is greenwash and that, you know, not giving out more plastic bags in supermarkets and, you know, very sort of slight things that are going on allows these multinationals and big companies to say that they have a green agenda, whereas, in fact, I haven't really seen that anywhere in the new Tesco that opened recently by us. And brand new big shop, I was hoping for so much more. Perhaps I'll be better off when Waitrose opens.
Right. Who wants to start?
Well, I happen to shop at Waitrose. I think there's a values base there which is not shared by some other supermarkets. But to your critical point, which is do people use limited areas of progress to try and blindside their critics or delude their consumers? Of course they do. And we've seen repeated examples of that. And I think one of the critical things that we have to do, we all have to do, is to spot those when they happen and talk about them publicly. And I don't know how many of you have actually, in a supermarket, raised those sorts of issues directly with staff. It is amazing. It's like writing to your politician. They don't get very much pushback or feedback. And when you do it, and particularly when a number of people do it, the impact can be disproportionate. But greenwashing will always be with us. It's why I talked about zero washing. We're already seeing it. We're already seeing companies announcing targets using that Z word and thinking that's going to delude people into to believing that they're really stretching. They really believe in the need to change not just their publicity activities but their business models. We again have to be extremely critical of that.
I'd agree that there is quite a lot of greenwashing around, and there is a tendency to get fixated on the wrong things, like plastic bags. I mean, plastic bags are important, but in relative scale terms, there are, as I think you're suggesting, some much bigger issues. And yes, there are a few companies that are really grasping the kind of radical change that needs to happen. But there are now more and more. So there are companies like Interface and even really big companies like Unilever. They really are setting very stretching targets, aiming for zero carbon and eventually zero waste. And even at a smaller level, I met a guy that runs a supermarket in North London. It's actually a Budgeon supermarket, but their outlets are actually kind of independents. And this guy is really pushing the agenda. So as an individual, the best thing we can do is to try and frequent or buy products from the companies that are genuinely pushing the agenda and criticize the ones that aren't.
Felicity. And I think I'm endorsing Michael's, you know, from a consumer point of view, absolutely vote with your feet, don't go to Tesco's. I personally, when I, being in the sustainability world, when you find out more about what companies are doing, you can very quickly decipher which feels like greenwash and feels like reality. But yes, companies like Unilever, companies like B&Q are making me think twice about where I'm buying my products from. Ideally, I'll go to the local as much as I can, but I think voting with our feet is the one thing that companies are probably very fearful of and something that we definitely don't do enough of.
So could we have, we're getting towards the end of our time. over there, please. Two questions, one after the other, please.
In terms of engineering our way to a better future and the way forward, we've been heard very inspiring things this evening, but I wonder whether the speakers are optimistic about the desperate struggle, I think, that we are facing and are involved in between the type of technologies that you have been talking about and those that were referred to at the beginning of the week, last Saturday, by Clive Hamilton, that are desperately struggling to dominate the planet in a way which all of us here would feel was terribly destructive. And yet the power and the money and the control behind those technologies seems to me to be something that we need to address and contemplate more about.
Another person wanted to contribute. The men are feeling rather intimidated now, I think. So anyway, young lady here.
My question's for Michael, and whether biomimicry and nature have any lessons to teach us about how to handle something like the Olympics, which explodes into an area and then fades away almost as quickly.
So I think the answers will have to be shorter now because we've only got about 10, 15 minutes now. Who wants to start? Nobody wants to start. Silence, maybe we should meditate instead of talking.
Well, I'm happy to start, you know. So, in answer to that, I'm going to leave that one, which I think is a brilliant question, to Michael and Felicity between them. Am I optimistic? I think, like Michael, I'm a bit nervous about optimism and pessimism. I'm not sure it's a scale that really helps terribly much, because after a day like today, I'm feeling, woo, you know, you can do anything, and then sometimes it's quite a bad day, and you listen to George Osborne say something, and your spirit falls, and So hopefulness is my sort of story rather than pessimism and optimism. And I am incredibly hopeful at the moment for one simple reason. Everything that you hear about these transitions to a more sustainable world are happening without any encouragement from markets, because our markets do not reflect the benefits of these green technologies. By not making big oil companies pay for the carbon they emit, we're basically allowing them to remain incumbent players in the marketplace. Everything you hear about renewable energy, that brilliant project you heard Michael talking about, all of this stuff is working against the grain of the market. So just think what would happen when the market began to get behind this. Now, will that happen? Well, in my opinion, it will happen, because I'm absolutely persuaded that eventually the politicians will realize that the cost of not addressing climate change is so much more horrendous than the cost of addressing it, that we'll get a price on a ton of carbon. And I think, personally, we'll get a cost on a ton of carbon within the next 6-7 years. I'm, in that respect, optimistic on carbon pricing. You watch what happens when carbon prices go to $25 to $50 a ton. This is a revolution that is kind of stacking up, just waiting to be unleashed. And I see no reason why some quite small changes of that kind wouldn't unleash that revolution. And when it did, all the horrors that we heard from Clive Hamilton about geoengineering our way out of a situation that we've created by putting so much CO2 into the atmosphere, then the geoengineering fantasies can kind of fade away again, because these technologies we've got, these low-carbon renewable technologies, are amazing. And the quicker we get there, the less we'll need the geoengineering fantasies.
You'll have to be fairly brief, I think, in all of your replies now.
Well, very quickly, one of the publications that routinely gets up my nose is The Economist, but I also enjoy reading it as well. And anyone who's read this week's edition will have seen the front cover story, which is about the melting of the Arctic ice. And there's a big section in the middle, which is about the implications of all of that. And one of the things I can't stand about The Economist is it can't actually remember long enough back to remember when it was arguing completely to the contrary. But to pick up Jonathon's point, I think the evidence is coming through now in the business and to some degree in the political media in ways I think will have a huge impact. And just to pick up a second point that he made, which is about geoengineering fantasies, these things are at the moment seen as fantasies. I had somebody who came into my office 3 weeks ago. He's planning to put 65,000-foot hoses up into the stratosphere. In fact, there was an experiment near here that was cancelled for rather different reasons, and then spray titanium dioxide into the stratosphere, basically a sunscreen for the Earth. If you ask me, I think within 15 to 20 years, we may well find ourselves at the point where politicians will want to do that. So I think we've really got to accelerate the low carbon.
But we heard about the fact that you know, some of the richest people in the world are now investing in this technology a week ago, so that was a bit of a worrying contribution to the discussion.
Responding to the first question about kind of obstacles, yes, there are certainly some big obstacles out there still, and it is very frustrating that we have a lot of the solutions that we need and they're not happening fast enough. But at the same time, I think there are reasons to be positive as well. I think there are some really big changes that have occurred over the last 10 to 20 years that we tend to forget about. Smoking, for one thing, drunk driving, attitudes to racism, those have changed enormously in a very short space of time. And I think the same thing could happen with our attitudes to some of these companies. And I've actually found it quite encouraging that some very big companies have come knocking on our door about the Sahara Forest Project, one that makes fizzy drinks, not the same one that was mentioned earlier. And we told them to piss off because they didn't meet our ethical standards, and they kept coming back. And we said, well, come back when you've made some genuine changes. Coming to the biomimicry question, yes, I think there are lots of examples of how biomimicry could influence the Olympics. There are loads of examples in nature of things that are ephemeral, things that are lightweight, that unfold very quickly, that inflate, that use a minimum of resources. I mean, if you just think about, say, a fruit tree and the blossom you see on a fruit tree, that's something that looks fantastic just for a fairly short amount of time, and then all those resources get recycled into further growth. And I think often there's a debate about more and more these days about prosperity without growth. Very good book, and I think it can be a mistake to talk about zero growth, because I think that is problematic. In nature, what you find is very high levels of growth, renewal, and decay. And I think a state of dynamic yeah. equilibrium is going to be a much easier one to bring about than a zero growth economy.
Now we're coming very close to the end of our time. I would actually like to use Chairman's prerogative to ask a question at the end of the discussion, which is, we haven't heard very much about policy. We've heard a lot about technology, we've heard a lot about entrepreneurship, we've heard a lot of exciting initiatives of the kind that you represent at the Olympics. But I mean, some of the most important changes that have taken place on this planet have not been driven by entrepreneurship, but by policy changes. I mean, take, for instance, feed-in tariffs. They're now been for renewable energy. They have now been introduced in about 50 or 60 countries around the world. And they've had a dramatic impact on accelerating not only the introduction of renewable energy, whether it's wind or solar or the others, but also innovation in the development of the technologies themselves. Now, we've had feed-in tariffs in this country, unfortunately, as soon as our dear current Prime Minister got into power, it was soon reduced to 50% or less than it was. But we have, for instance, in this country, had landfill taxes. Now, they have had a significant impact on our recycling patterns. In other countries, in China, for instance, they're introducing a circular economy legislation. And that, all of that changes the behavior patterns of finance, of entrepreneurship, and so on. So would you like to comment on the importance of policy in the changes that we are all seeking?
Can't do without it, shouldn't depend upon it. It'll have to do. You told me I've only got 1 minute. Okay. So my favourite policy right now, which is just lurking in the wings, and we've now got the French and the Germans queuing up behind it, is the idea of a global financial transaction tax. And I am absolutely persuaded that if we could get the world's large financial country, the countries with large financial centers in them, to come behind a global financial transaction tax, it would liberate the world from its complete constipation that it's got at the moment, generate huge amounts of new revenues, and do a fantastic amount for poverty and sustainability.
Very simple follow-on point. Policy often follows innovation. And I think one of the things that I have confidence in is that eventually the policies will come. But they'll be fought tooth and nail. And if we think what we've seen in terms of resistance from the incumbents is about as bad as it gets, we haven't really seen, I think, anything yet. There is an immense battle to be fought against the Koch brothers in the States and a bunch of other people. But I think there's an alternative to policy in the middle zone, which is where you see a growing number of business leaders groups coming together to themselves push things like Jochen Zeitz's environmental profit and loss accounting methodology. A growing number of companies are beginning to think about how do they come in behind that. 4 to 5 years in the future, when that's a little bit more demonstrated, it will be much easier for the policymakers then to hopefully step up to the mark. But I'd rather have no policy than erratic policy that bounces all over the place.
I'm in favour of policies that don't try and mandate the actual change, but actually create the right conditions out of which that change emerges. And I think a very good shift would be if we were to start moving taxation away from employment, there's nothing inherently wrong with employment, and more towards the use of resources. Because that would actually really drive the kind of innovation that you can find in biomimicry, where you can often develop solutions that achieve a factor 100 saving in resource use, but at the moment it just doesn't stack up, because resources in many cases are effectively free.
Mm. Thank you.
And from Olympics' point of view, we are very open and transparent once the game's finished, and actually now the construction is finished, in terms of what we've learnt, what's gone well and what hasn't gone well. And we are committed to the government in terms of all of the investment that they have made to share that. So I hope that we provide, and perhaps one of my legacies, is that we can actually influence the policies going forward and perhaps give them the armament and the ammunition they need to make those brave steps.
So my suggestion that you might end up as in a policy unit number 10 was not entirely misplaced, was it?
I'll think about that one.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, I think we're coming to the end of our time here today. But before we leave this room, I would first of all like to thank the one person, apart from Jonathon, I have to say, who has really made these Schumacher lectures possible, and is my dear friend sitting quietly over there, Nick Hart-Williams, who has been the key organizer. Stand up, Nick. Come on. Yeah, so can you all stand up as well? Anybody? Come on, stand up. Please stand up. It's been amazing how what you've achieved, and really the partnership between Forum for the Future and Schumacher Society has been amazingly, remarkably effective here the last week, and I think the whole week has been a huge success. So thank you everybody for, first of all, making it happen, but secondly for coming.
I wouldn't butt in if it wasn't so important.
Yeah?
I know you just picked out...
Who are you, anyway?
I'm Darren Hall.
Stand up.
Director of the festival, and I have to thank all of the volunteers, and Lucy, and a number of other people who are, some of them are in green T-shirts. The three of us couldn't have done any of this without all of those people. Lucy here, and others that aren't here, so apologies for butting in, but it's absolutely, I really, really need to thank them.
Well, I think all of this bodes extremely well for the future of Bristol as a truly pioneering green city, not only in Britain, but in Europe, hopefully, as we will have the results of the Green Capital vote in just 2 or 3 weeks from now. So thank you everybody for coming, for contributing, for not only being here tonight, for coming here several times, as I know it's been marvelous and wonderful, and hopefully we'll have the same thing or something even more substantial next year. Will we have that? Yes, I think so. Forum is already committed to it, and I think Schumacher as well. Thanks everybody for coming, and yes, and tweeting. Yes, there's book signing outside, and there's two books here that are just recently been released, Michael Pawlyn's book and John's book. And there's also, we want to hear your great green ideas, and there's a website called greatgreenideas@biggreenweek.com. So please contribute to that website. I think it's very important to also hear from you the outcome of the discussions we've had here and what it's meant to you. So thank you very much. And there's more happening this evening, isn't there, in the Colston Hall, starting at 8 o'clock. Okay. All the best. Bye-bye.